So hello and welcome everybody. I'm super excited to be doing this yet again. As you guys know, I love talking and love listening, and I love having interesting guests with us. And today we have invited a fabulous guest, Jeremy Streten, co-founder of NPR Law, and very interesting guy, Jeremy. Jeremy, would you like to introduce yourself to our audience? Tell us a little bit about you.
Thanks, Mish. And being a lawyer, I'll try and keep my words to a minimum. But, so I founded NPR Law in 2022. It was after I had run my own law firm for about 10 years with a business partner, where I decided to split that relationship. And I really wanted to build a firm focused on property and resumption work, which I know we're going to talk about a bit about if people don't know what that is. So I've been a lawyer at this stage for a little over 20 years now. I worked in a big city law firm. Actually, it started quite small, Mish. It was an 8-person law firm. And when I left, it was about 80 people. And it's in the last 12 years since I've left there, it's about the same as it was. A really good place to work at. But I've been doing property and resumption work throughout that whole time. And I really love it. I really have a passion for helping people to make sure that they get what they deserve and they buy their properties correctly. So that's a bit about me.
Okay, fantastic. So you're talking about resumption, and I'm sure most of the audience, I'm assuming that most of the audience wouldn't know about resumption. Tell us a little bit about resumption.
Yeah, so resumption is where the government is going to resume your land. So whenever someone buys a property in Queensland, especially a freehold title, they might have noticed that on the title search, there's a little encumbrance called deed of grant. And basically, that's the crown, so the governor who's representing the king or queen, whoever it is at the time, mm-hmm. granting you the right to have that land. And at any time under the constitution, the government can actually come and take that land back if they've got a reason to do so for public purposes. So they might want to put a new road through. They might want to widen a road. They might want to build new schools. They might want to put pipes underneath it. They might want to put power lines over the top of it. So the government has that power, and that's called resuming the property. Another term that people use, this is more in an American version, is eminent domain. Basically, it means the same thing if people have heard that term. It's where the government can come in, take the land, and in doing so, they've got to pay you fair compensation for the land.
Okay. So, and what is fair compensation when you're working with government?
So what the government agencies do is they employ a valuer, and you get a valuer, and basically in the value of anything, Mish, there's the value that you go in is really high, the value that they come in is very low, and you basically meet somewhere
in the middle.
And I work with a valuer who's been doing this for about 40 years. I've been doing it for about 15 years, and what we've learned is just we've learned all the tricks of the trade. We could do a whole 4-hour podcast. We do town halls where we explain.
We'll keep that for another show. We'll go to the nuts and bolts for another show. The big thing that I wanted to ask you though about resumption is because there are quite a lot of properties that are leasehold. So leasehold, AZT, and like Brisbane airports, that's all leasehold. So that could fall into the bracket of resumption, couldn't it?
It could. And so leasehold properties can be resumed as well. Leases are generally for 99 years. So the value would be adjudged based on how much longer is left to go in the lease. So that doesn't come up too often. I've only probably done about two of those in my whole career. But generally, it's depending on how long is left in the lease, and that may affect the value that you're going to get for the property.
Okay. Well, it's always a consideration, and leaseholds are always a little bit tricky because you're not dealing with one lease. You're dealing with a multitude of leases and course, all the solicitors and everybody along the way.
Absolutely.
So we've got a couple of questions that listeners have been asking, and they sent through questions, and we cherry pick out of those, and we're going to speak about a couple of those things. So with regards to key legal aspects that a commercial property buyer should consider during the due diligence process. Now, we've done quite a little bit about this, but you're fresh and new with us. Give us your take on this one.
I think that the first thing that we need to do when we're acting for a buyer who's looking at a commercial property or even a residential property that they're doing due diligence on, we really want to understand their objectives first. Why are they buying the property? Are they buying it to develop it? Are they buying it to knock it down and rebuild? Are they buying it just to hold for the next 50 years? Or are they buying it for a short-term purchase and then they're going to sell it off in a few years that they see a gain in the market? So it really, that's the first question, because that then determines the kind of searches that we do and how much from a legal due diligence we'll do. So probably the most important thing is checking the title to the property, making sure that the person who's selling the property is actually entitled to sell the property. and making sure that there's nothing around the property that might cause a problem for you to hold that property for whatever your goal is. And one of those things, Mish, is actually resumptions. So you know, if you're buying along a highway, or if you're buying in a corridor that might be a future highway, you and I live in Brisbane, there are two new highways, one going north and one going south in the next decade or so. And people, when they bought their homes or bought these properties, they're buying properties in the way of a resumption. And they may not have known that. So doing their due diligence around what the government might want for the property in the future are really important, because that could affect the value of what you're buying.
Absolutely. So that would kind of err on the side of town planning as well. I mean,
100%. Yeah.
Most certainly when you're buying a property like that, you always want to have a look at town planning. But from a legal perspective, I think very important to know, as you say, what the objectives are.
Yeah. And then knowing what the objectives are, then you're going back into, you know, the searches. And so there are different levels of, say, council searches that we can do that tell us different information about the property. And some people, you know, will need a much more in-depth search that they might need when they're buying the property, as opposed to someone who's wanting to do less with the property. So it really, you know, the aspects of due diligence that matter are really determined by that, by what they want to do with the property. And then we can tailor the legal due diligence to suit them.
Yeah, that makes sense. Look, a lot of the properties that we do, although we do a fair amount of uplift properties, but those are all sorts of things that we're very mindful about. And I like the fact that you were saying you really like to know what the investor is doing when they're buying that property, because I think that is super important, you know, just to give some sort of scope on what those searches should be. Because a lot of people, you know, they might turn those searches down. I always entice them to do the searches. You know, when you're spending $2-4 million on a property, a couple hundred bucks on the search, it's well worth it.
100%. It always boggles my mind, Mish, when people don't want to spend $200-300 on a search when they're spending $5-6 million on a property. But anyway, that's their choice, but it definitely is worth it to protect themselves. Yeah.
A little bit of a stinger in the tail there.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
What about the importance of environmental assessments in commercial properties? Now, I know I've had a heap of experience in like buying fuel stations, for instance, or fuel stations that have been converted that haven't had their environmental certifications done. And it really does put a handbrake on the entire deal. Tell us a little bit about that, your experience.
Yeah, so this again comes back to what you're buying the property for. If you're buying a petrol station because you want it to be a petrol station for the next 50 years, well, that's great. You, there's less of a concern than if you want to, and this has happened a lot, which I'm sure you've seen recently, where people buy a petrol station and they want to develop it into a block of units, or they want to do something around the property. No, I have seen some do it, and I have seen some do it, especially over in St. Lucia Way. There's been a couple where they've basically sealed the whole property in concrete, and then built a high rise, lot of units. So,
look, I think it is possible to do. I mean, it is a little bit of an expense, and you've got to do your feasibility on that. So, if you're building a 30 story high rise on top of it, and you're only paying $50,000 for the environmental certification, happy days. You know, if council allows you to do that, then yeah, sure.
Yeah, that's 100%.
Yeah,
100% correct. And so that comes back to, again, where the property is, what it's been used for in the past. When we do a search, one of the searches that we can do as a lawyer is an environmental search of the environmental register to see whether or not the property's actually been registered on the environmental register as contaminated land or affected land as well. So that's a really important search. It's actually one of the ones that the Law Society requires that we do for every single conveyance to make sure that if there is anything on there. We've had ones, Mish, where there are storage dumps from the World Wars. And so they were used as storage dumps, and they had lots of weapons on them. And they still had some weapons in bunkers and stuff on the property that people weren't even aware of. So it's well worth finding this out. Yeah.
That's exciting. What areas are those in? I would think that could be down Wynnum Way.
Yeah, down Wynnum Way and also out in west a little bit. There was some secret ammo stores that were put out in the wars, and even some Ipswich Way. I've seen those as well. So yeah, there's been quite a few that I've seen where there's been some stuff stored on land.
So do they do impact studies for contamination? Obviously, I mean, I'm assuming that they're looking for contamination to see whether there is some sort of contamination on those lands.
That's right. Yeah. So that's what they're looking for. They're looking for chemicals or whatever it is that might be in the land. The petrol station is the most obvious one because we all use petrol stations all the time. But there's lots of other reasons why there might be contamination from if a certain industry was on that property beforehand. So we're really any sort of industry, really, that where something's been manufactured, slaughterhouses, those kind of places. They all show up on a search, and it's something that you've got to be really careful of. And again, this comes back to the objectives of why you're buying the property. So if you're buying the property because you want to just keep whatever's on there, then that's a different consideration to if you want to do something different with it. Yeah.
And again, so long as there is no contamination, or if there is contamination, it's within the boundaries of whatever the business is, is feasible. That makes total sense.
Absolutely.
Yeah, these we've had some issues with wood mills as well, and you think wood's a natural product. Well, actually, it gets processed, so you've got to do those contamination searches.
Absolutely, you do. To
just make sure that you're buying, or if you intend keeping, I saw a beautiful woodshed that was being converted, and that was one of the questions that I asked, and they hadn't actually checked on the contamination. That, again, was a huge handbrake.
Absolutely, it would be.
It would have turned into a beautiful, shabby chic sort of uplift property, but they had to go through that whole process, it's a massive process.
It would be.
Okay, so we've got a note here. How can a buyer ensure that the intended use of the commercial property aligns with the local zoning regulations and land restrictions?
So this comes back to, and I mentioned it before in the due diligence, it's around making sure that you get the right searches done for what you're wanting to do. So really what you want to be doing is getting the right council planning search, and all the councils in Queensland have the search. I'm sure it's the same Australia-wide, where you have all of the different councils will give you what that is. And if you're not sure, sometimes we get, especially where a client might buy a shopping center, they might not be sure that they might not be allowed to have a certain use type on the property. So that's where we might get a town planner involved and ask them the question and get them to investigate what that is. So really it's around doing your searches, making sure that the searches are done right and you're aware of all those. And if there's any ambiguity, talk to a local town planner. Usually a local one's the best one, I find, because they know the area the best and they know the rules and regulations, and they'll be able to answer that question for you.
That's such a classic. It's like the certificate of occupancy. So we've got a classic one at the moment, an old bloke well into his 80s. He's built and developed these little, call them man caves from probably about the 70s or the 80s. So they're a little bit rough. Mm. And he's got no certificates of occupancy for this entire building. And as a result of that, it's very difficult to buy this building. And we're trying to explain to the guy, that we'll hold on, we'll wait until they get that. But, you're dealing with somebody in their early 80s who really does take his time. So it's a great property. Can't wait to get moving on it. But in the meantime, we're kind of stuck.
And I think, Mish, what I've seen a lot of times is, especially the older generations, they just did things when they wanted to do things, and there weren't as many regulations. And the law, even in my 20 years of being a lawyer, I've seen that the amount of regulations just skyrocket upwards. It's just been insane how many more laws there are and how many more rules there are. If you go back to someone like an 80-year-old gentleman who grew up when there wasn't a lot of rules, he probably just doesn't care about that and thinks that everything should be done the other way. And that's fine. It either brings down the value of the property or just makes it impossible to actually settle on them. So, that's always a challenge.
Yeah, and we always find these, and these are the kinds of properties that we keep our eye on. And because ultimately, if he wants to sell and he can't sell now for instance, the certificate of occupancy, that's a bit of a handbrake, it's still going to be a problem in 6 months' time. Mm-hmm. Yep. So it's just kicking the can down the road.
Yep. 100%. Yeah.
It's exactly the same. Mm-hmm. Okay, so this is a classic, and this is what we look at all the time. What should buyers look for in existing lease agreements with purchasing a commercial property? I think we could have a whole topic on this for a month.
We absolutely could. We could be talking about this all the time, because probably the most classic problem is people don't actually read these documents. And what a lot of people don't understand is that whilst there's the commercial tenancy agreement from the REIQ, virtually every lease is different in and has its own terms that you need to be aware of. There's no such thing other than the REIQ thing. It's a standard lease. And I would argue that that's not even really a standard lease because it changes. People put in special conditions. They make little changes here. There are, I can't even think of how many versions of that document that I've seen over the last 20 years. Yeah, so the classic thing that I always hear from people is, oh, it's just a standard lease. I'm like, the very first thing I say is, there's no such thing as a standard lease. So I always say, let us review it from a legal perspective, and then you've got to look at it from a commercial perspective. And from a commercial perspective, we want to be checking out, you know, is it like a commercial rent? Is it actually, you know, propping up the value of the property the right way? But then from a legal perspective, we're looking at the tenant, making sure the tenant isn't someone who's going to go belly up soon, but based on any searches that we can do. Now, we can't do anything more than what's in the public record, but we can still check that. We want to check that, you know, the market rent, as I said before, is right. We want to really check through a lease, especially if one's been signed recently, where making sure there's no outs for the tenant. So making sure that there's not some clause where the tenant can get out of it that you don't realize is in there. You know, sometimes, and it's sad that people do this, people will sneak in a clause that will let them out of the lease. And if you don't read it the whole way through, then you'll miss out on those things.
Oh, that's a classic. I remember doing a property up on the Sunshine Coast. Lovely property, really great property. Mm-hmm. I think it had about a 5-year lease on it, but it had a 3-month escape clause on it. It means that, and it was really, really well hidden because it was in clause 3.8.3.2.1.
So it was drafted by a lawyer right there, I can tell you.
And it was like, we read this lease. When I spoke to the agent about it, I said, but mate, this effectively is a three-month lease. Mm. And he said, no, it's a 5-year lease. It's just got that escape clause. And I said, well, realistically, the tenant can terminate this lease within 3 months. They can give us 3 months notice. So it really is a 3-month lease. So you really need to know, you know, your stuff and have somebody scrutinizing that lease and making sure that you don't have those little clauses that are 3.8.3.1.2, whatever it is. You know,
if you start seeing a lease that's got that many dots behind numbers, you probably want to start to behind the clause numbers, you probably want to be concerned because it sounds like something's been snuck in there. The next one to really think about, what are your obligations as a landlord? So what are the things that you're going to have to do? What outgoings are going to be paid by the tenant? You and I were recently talking about one where that was a concern of the gentleman who was looking at buying the property. What are the outgoings that are going to be paid, and making sure that the tenant's paying all the outgoings? Or if they're not, then knowing what outgoings you've got to pay and knowing what's the budget for those and how might they change going up and down. And probably the last one that I think is really important is, what are your obligations to repair parts of the building? So whose obligation is it to repair air conditioning in, say, an office or a shop?
That is really important, really, really important. We've been doing quite a lot of acquisitions on warehouses where you've got gantry cranes and you've got roller shutter doors. Now, when you look at a building like this, usually you think, okay, air conditioners, and you might have about 5-10 air conditioners, and that's what people think about initially. But I was standing with a client and I said to him, no, mate, we've got to look at every single roller shutter door. Every single roller shutter door needs to be serviced, and we need to see service contracts. Gantry cranes, who does it belong to? Who does the servicing? Who does the replacement in the event of breakdown? And all of that should be in your lease. We had a very interesting one as well. A water disbursement pump. It was an underground pump to disperse water in the event of floods. And when I spoke to the seller about it, he was just like, oh, yeah, it always has worked. And I said, well, great. I'm pleased it always has worked. Then you should have service contracts. And he said, no, we don't bother servicing it. I said, well, how can you prove to me that it's going to work when we need it to work?
Right. I mean, anything mechanical needs to be repaired. Yeah, like the building where my office is, there's three tenancies on the top floor. About 7 months ago, the air conditioning in our unit died. And luckily for me as the tenant, the landlord had to replace the unit. And then about 2 months after that, the next door one fell over as well, and he had to pay for that one as well. So knowing, and we're talking 20, 30 grand exercises in, because cranes have got to lift air conditioning units in and all the rest of that. And so that's a huge cost to be aware of. And that comes back to that's what you're looking for in the lease agreement. And then you want to know, you know, how often are these things being serviced? Because as the you're going to become the owner of the property, if you need, if it might need replacing in the next couple of years, and you may need to fund that. And so you need to make sure you've got the cash flow or at least the capital saved up to be able to do that. So all of these things, these are all the really important things, because at the end of the day, when you're buying a commercial property, what you're really buying are the relationships with the tenants. So the tenants, because they're going to be paying you your income. And so you need to know what that relationship is. And I would say not only do you need to get good advice from a lawyer and an agent to read through it all, you also need to read through it yourself, because there are things that we may not know about that might be a concern of yours or something from your past that you need to have. And so I know a lot of people go, I don't want to read a 30-page lease document. This is the value of your property. So you want to make sure that you've read it at least once and raised any concerns that you've got. Because I've had clients in the past, Mish, who have read leases. They've been completely fine from my side, but then I found out down the track that they had a problem with a previous tenant on another building 10 years ago that they were going to have again with the same lease. And we were able to negotiate a change on it because they read the document. But I had no idea about it because I can't know everything that's in their head from the last how long they've been investing in property.
Of course, that makes total sense. It really does. And yeah, I think that's the kind of thing that most people don't do. Is they rely on their solicitors, their lawyers, their buyer's agents to do that, to read through those leases. And yeah, you can't know what's going on in everybody's copybook.
No, can you? That's right.
So what are the steps that buyers should take to verify the property's title and ownership? Mm. Oh my goodness, I'm busy going through one of these right now where it's a new build, new 5+5+5 year lease. It's a great lease, fantastic tenant, all of that. However, the lease has been registered in one number and the title is registered in another number. And we're trying to find out, you know, just working on this, trying to make sure that everything is one. And it's just going back and forward and back and forward. It's been a little bit of a schmozzle. So that's one little red flag. I'm sure you've seen a hell of a lot more.
Yeah, well, I think the situation with this now in 2023, when we're recording this, is a lot better than it has been, especially when I first started in the law. So, yeah, we have a title register where everything that is meant to be, who the owner is, who has the leases, is all meant to be registered on title. And that's really meant to be the Bible of what's actually registered and who owns what, right? That's the purpose of it. In the past, though, you didn't have to have the ID checks and the verification that you have to have now. So in the past, back when I was working in the city law firm, back when I think it was about 20 people there, I said it went from 8 to 80, and back when there was about 20 people there, so about 4 years in, we had a client who, they were a mortgage broker, and they were buying properties for people, right, as a mortgage broker. We were taking their instructions, and we never met the clients. The clients were always off working off an oil rig off Queensland. Now, I'm not sure whether there are any oil rigs off Queensland. This is one of the things that got our spidey senses going. And what we discovered was this mortgage broker was entering into contracts with fake names and basically borrowing the money, pocketing the equity, and then leaving the properties to go. And so back then, the ID checks weren't that rigorous. You just had to see like a copy of a license and a birth certificate, say. And if you saw that, then that was all good, right? That experience actually changed the way that people had to be verified in Queensland. And it was actually my conveyancer at the time. I was an employee solicitor, but I supervised a conveyancer at the time, and she and I are the ones who worked it out. We were like looking at this going, the doctor's name on that birth certificate is the same as the last name of the father on that one, and it looks the same. And we worked out that it was all fraudulently done. So one of the rules that came in after that, so we took all that to the law society and to the police. We had security guards in our office for about a year because these people were, they weren't necessarily the most law-abiding citizens, let's put it that way. And we were concerned about our physical safety. Like, in all seriousness, we had security guards sleeping in our office for a time before we handed over files to the police. And that precipitated a change where we now have to properly verify ID and we have to have proper copies. We need to, in most cases, see the original and we can see that people actually are ID'd properly. So I think that's a good thing, personally, Mish. I think that, having rigor around the title system is better. It can be painful because we also need to redo it every couple of years. Even so, I had a client recently who we verified at the old law firm a couple of years ago, and then we had to redo it because he was buying somewhere, and he's got all mad. And I said, look, at the end of the day, these are the rules. We need to comply with them now. And, you know, that's a good thing because we're making sure that the title system is rigorous, and it really doesn't take that much to verify your identity.
And at the end of the day, it's to the buyer's protection. You know, it's to your advantage, really. Mm-hmm.
It's to everyone's advantage because that's what these people were doing. They were literally defrauding banks. They were taking extra money from the sale, and then they're pocketing the difference, and then they let these properties just sit there, and then the banks would foreclose on them, and they were just pocketing, you know, 50, 60 grand at the time. And so that needed to change.
Gee whiz. Where was I around about that time? I would have been happy to pick those properties up.
Well, the mid 2000s, this happened.
No, nowhere close. Yeah, I think, you know, things have tightened up quite a lot, and you do need to jump through quite a lot of hoops and loops. But again, well worth it. I always say the analogy of buying a commercial property is a little bit like going skydiving. You know, to find that property, it's a little bit like doing the training to go skydiving, getting on the aeroplanes, a little bit like going unconditional. You know, it's a little bit nerve-wracking, and you've got to do all your due diligence and make sure you're probably strapped in and your chute's going to work, and, you know, it's really scary. And then going unconditional is stepping out of that aeroplane. You crack yourself to get out of that aeroplane. And once you let go, you're flying down. That's the process between unconditional and settlement, where you think, phew, I've done this, everything's right, everything's coming through. And then settlement is like landing. And hope you have a soft landing, really.
Right. Yep.
And afterwards, you're on terra firma, and you look back and you think, wow, gee, that was great. That was amazing. You know, you think, let's do this again.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
That's my little analogy of buying a commercial property. It really is a journey.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
So, Jeremy, tell us, with regards to the legal considerations, should buyers keep in mind when structuring finance agreements or purchase contracts for commercial property? Now, I think this is a topic that we could speak about for another week, but give us your take on that.
So my take, and from a legal perspective, it's always better to keep all your properties in separate entities if you can. So from a legal protection point of view, you want to have different entities owning different properties. Now, that can cause problems from a financing point of view, because banks will often want to cross-collateralize everything and make sure that, yep, you know, if you default over here, they can sell over here, and this and that and the other. But as much as possible, you want to separate your holdings and separate your risks, so that you're not going to, if something goes wrong with one property, that you can keep other properties and all of that. So I know that for some people that won't work, but as best you can. I know that when I've bought properties in the past, I've always set up a separate trust and kept that property in that trust just for that purpose. There might be a bit of extra tax, there might be a bit of extra setup costs and all the rest of that. But for me, protecting the asset from, you know, being able to be attacked for something else is much more valuable for that. So I think doing that is really important, and keeping as many silos for your financial arrangements as possible is better. So yeah, I even do that with my different businesses, Mish. I have different banks for different businesses so that you know, it's not all in one, all my eggs aren't in one basket. And I just think that's a good arrangement, especially when you're buying commercial properties, because if you do have something go wrong with a commercial property, that can cause a lot of financial hardship that you do want to isolate as much as you can to a different, to one entity, then not let it affect other ones.
Well, that is, as far as I'm concerned, that is 101 of commercial buying commercial properties. And you so rightfully said, even your businesses, realistically, I often say to people, buying a commercial property is a little bit like buying a business. You are really going into a business. So run it like a business. And one of the other things, I was chatting to a client recently, and I said to them, even your bank accounts, open a bank account for that entity and don't use it for anything else. It makes your accounting simple, makes your asset protection simple, and you keep it clean. You've got in and you've got out. That's it. Simple. Mm-hmm. And the bloke was saying to me, well, you know, I'm accumulating properties. You're suggesting that I have like 15 bank accounts. And I said, yeah, mate, that's it. Yep. It's full administration, really. If you're looking for that asset protection and that certainty, keep it clean and simple. It's easier for the accountants. It's easier for the legal team. Right throughout.
And most banks will let you have fee-free online accounts if you just keep it online. So having a transaction account, most of them will let you do that. So as long as you don't want to go into the branch, and who does these days, that should be fine.
Oh, if you can find the branches. What branches?
That's right. That's very true. Very true.
Yeah. I've been doing a property fairly recently where we were discussing the lease. Now, we were talking about earlier about when you're doing a lease back on a property, whether to do it at unconditional or at settlement. Mm-hmm. I'm vigilant about this. I am fastidious that it needs to be done at unconditional. And in the contract, it was a little bit something that kind of slipped through where we went unconditional and satisfied due diligence. But for some reason, the word satisfied building and pest was not articulated in the text that went through to the other side. Mm. And as it went through the process of unconditional, we went right through to settlement. And at settlement, the sellers used the fact that it hadn't been verbally stated that we had satisfied building and pest to wiggle around in this contract at settlement. Have you ever had something like that?
I haven't, but I do know what you're talking about here. So what I think the really important thing is, you've got to read the contract and make sure that all of the conditions are properly satisfied. So one of the lessons I learned very early on was to always actually say, you know, I'm satisfied pursuant to clause, I'm satisfied without due diligence, pursuant to clause, blah. Because that would then also flag the building and pest that you haven't actually satisfied that condition. So I can see how that would happen, because human beings make mistakes. We all know that. And things get missed. So I think that the big thing is about reading the contract, understanding what the conditions are, and making sure that they are all satisfied. Using that to try and get out of the contract is a bit cute, though. I don't know what the outcome was, but of that one. But I'd say that in all this stuff, you never want to go to court, right? But you've always got to be thinking about, from a negotiation point of view or thinking about your position, what would happen if we went to court on that? And I would think it would be very unlikely that they'd get up in court if due diligence is satisfied, if those words were used. Well, that would ordinarily include building and pest. Now, it's not good to miss that, if it's especially because if they're separate clauses, especially. And so that's why one of my checks is always to go through and go, okay, what are the clauses that are subject to us doing something, and that we've got to satisfy ourselves, and then make sure you mention those clauses so that they're all there. It does happen, though, and I'm sure the lawyer got very, very small when they realized they'd made that mistake. But I also wouldn't have thought that it would necessarily fly to keep you to get out of the contract that way.
But it was a very interesting situation, because this one in particular was a lease back and everybody was in agreement with it. And the seller was in agreement with it. And of course, he was putting a lease on the building. And it was a great business and had the 5-year lease on it. But there was something in the lease that he was wiggling around with regards the value per square meter, the cost per square meter. And all of this came up, and they used the leverage of the fact that the building and pest had not been satisfied to do that wiggle in the end. Anyway, long story short, we managed to settle the property with not too much, correspondence and communications and all of that. We managed to sort it out. And it really was just somebody being a little bit, finding a little dot that hadn't been dotted.
And on that, what I'd say is, if you're on the other side of that, just be careful that you're not spending lots of money on a lawyer to find some little, funny way that you might get out of it, because lawyers make lots of money, especially if they're charging on time, and I don't, but a lot of lawyers do. And if they're charging you based on the hours that they work on a file, and I was doing the inverted commas up with my hands, but on the hours that they work, then sometimes my colleagues will deliberately make things go for longer just to try and make their fees higher. So just be wary of that too. And I always take the attitude, let's be commercial. How do we make sure this deal gets done, and not looking for those things?
Yeah, absolutely. And that really is, you're looking for an outcome. Mm. You're really working towards an outcome.
That's right.
We had a question that came through from one of our clients. Interesting question, and I was wondering where this came from. But anyway, under what circumstances or conditions can a contract be cancelled or once unconditional, if any?
If it's truly unconditional, then there really wouldn't be anything unless, say, the property is destroyed or flooded, or, and we've had that recently in Brisbane, unless there's like some physical damage to the property. The thing that I'd say is that in those standard terms and conditions, the ones from the REIQ, there are lots of little things that you need to make sure that you're across. And so when people think things are unconditional, it may not be 100% unconditional. You know, if there are problems with the property as well, problems with the property alignment, then there can be situations where you can get out of the contract, depending on the, they're very much circumstance dependent. And there's whole textbooks. I've got a whole bookcase behind my screen here that are just full of textbooks of that go into all this stuff. They're great bedtime reading. If you ever need, if anyone ever needs something to help them sleep, I've got a lot of books here.
I'm sure. I was just thinking, oh my God, you're talking about that. I'm falling asleep already just thinking about it.
and so it really depends on what the contract says. And what's been satisfied and what hasn't been satisfied, and if there's any problems with the property. So the classic one is if there's a major problem with the boundary of the property and it's like goes through the house and that wasn't disclosed and it should have been known, then that can cause lots of problems. But generally, there's not a lot of circumstances where you can get out of an unconditional contract. Yeah, as I said, like a truly unconditional contract, you're not getting out of, but one that's just a traditional contract, there might be little things where you can get out.
Yeah, we've had a situation fairly recently where it was a shopping center that we were busy looking at. We went unconditional, and the night before it was about to settle, the property popped a pipe burst and it flooded 50% of the property. Now, I mean, this is another topic completely about insurance, but anyway, the long and the short is we couldn't settle on the property. There's no ways. You know, this happened on a Sunday and we were meant to be settling the property on a Monday. Mm. And we, of course, said, well, there's no ways that we can settle the property. And the seller was kind of going, you know, what are they going to do? How does this work? And we were kind of going, well, you know, it's got to go through the motions. Long story short, it took about a month to go through insurance and another 2 months for the repairs to be done. The great thing is that by the time the insurance had done the repairs, they had added tremendous value to the building. So so the building was the valuation of the building at the end of it was actually quite a lot higher than what we were purchasing the property for. Yep. So it worked out well in the favor of the purchaser.
Yeah, for sure.
That was a little bit of a wiggle where the seller potentially wanted to wiggle out of it, or the buyer wanted to wiggle out of it. And again, very sensitive communications, very sensitive negotiations.
Yeah.
It was that we had to go through. My buyer at the time was asking, how can he get out of this? You know?
Yeah, absolutely. And again, that comes back to the conditions in the contract and what the conditions say and whether that is something that you can use to get out of the contract at the end of the day.
Yep. And in that case, made it very, very difficult. And no, there's no getting out. I think there are very few contracts that you can get out of at that point, and it would really cost quite a lot in order to get out of that contract. Another question came through. What could happen if we don't pay our deposits on time? Classic. I get this all the time.
Well, the short answer is you're in breach of your contract, and the seller can terminate the contract. Now, there's actually some school of thought, and again, there's whole textbooks written about this stuff, maybe not whole textbooks written on this topic, but there's lots of cases on this topic where even if you pay it late and you've made good your default under the contract. Say you've got a 30-day contract and the deposit's due to be paid when you sign the contract, but you pay it 48 hours late. There is an argument, a legal argument to say that even if you've paid the deposit late, that you're still in breach of the contract because you didn't pay it at the beginning. And so I haven't actually ever had a seller try this on either side, but there's an argument saying that they could still terminate the contract because you were in breach at that time and they could take the deposit. Now, there's this concept of when you're in breach of a contract that you can make good that default. And so my argument back to that would always be, well, I've made good the default, so you can't rely upon that. But strictly legally speaking, you could the seller could terminate the contract and then try and take the deposit, and then they could try and sell the property. If they sold it for less, then they could go you for any difference there. So what I always recommend, and we do as a law firm, is always put in there 2 to 3 business days, or either 2 days or 3 days, the longer the better, to give you time to pay that deposit. Because a lot of the time, especially in this day and age where everything's done electronically, you may not know that the seller signed the contract. And you might find out at 4:55, and you may not see the contract until the next day. And so you may not know. So you could technically be in default of the contract until the next morning, just because you didn't know that that was there. So I would say, if you can, get 2 or 3 days to pay that deposit. And if you can't, then just pay it straight up into the... Yeah. So long as it's going into an agent or a solicitor's trust account, I'm fine with it. It's just never pay the deposit to the seller directly.
No, that's an absolute no. And of course, I mean, if you're doing that deposit on a Friday afternoon, it's not going to reflect until 2-3 days later anyway, on a Monday morning.
That's right.
So you always need that little bit of gray area. Hedge your bets, make sure that you're always in the safe place. We actually bought a building a couple of years ago. It was just when the market was turning, and I think we went unconditional on the building when the prices were still very market relative at a very good yield. Mm-hmm. And by the time the due diligence period and everything had gone through, I think the seller had seller's remorse. They didn't want to sell the building. So they were cracking the whip on every single thing. And I remember having a thought about that and thinking, hell no, we're going to prepare that deposit and it's going to be ready and it's going to be paid well on time. Mm-hmm. So there's no ways that they can. And it's something to be very aware of where the seller's intentions are as well, or whether the seller's intentions have changed in mm-hmm. any way. So when you do these acquisitions, be aware of that.
Yeah, and in this, and the market, the way the market's been the last few years, this has been something that's come up lots of times, hasn't it? Because prices have been increasing, and people feel like they've sold the property too cheaply. So yeah, it does happen. Yeah.
Yes, and well, that's it. Seller's remorse, but you've got to catch it and make sure that you're crossing your T's and dotting your I's.
100%.
So yeah, if it's a leaseback, but the lease needs to be done, what would you recommend, that the lease needs to be done by unconditional or settlement? Now, I know what my sentiments are about this, and I think I mentioned it earlier. I have a lot of pushback about this with selling agents. What's your take on it?
My take on it is similar to yours. It should be done before it's unconditional, so that we can make sure that the lease is signed correctly. The only caveat I'll make that is you could still make the contract subject to the lease being signed, so long as you've already agreed to the terms. So if you know that the lease terms and that the lease terms are agreed before you enter into the contract, then I would say you want it signed before unconditional. I'd probably go as far as to say, if there is a lease back, I'd really most of the time want to see it signed before you actually enter into the contract. I'd go back a little bit further. And the reason for that is that often people do this to try and avoid the going concern, or make it a going concern, so they avoid the GST. If you're doing that, then there is an argument, and I deal with lots of different people buying commercial properties, have for many, many years, who all have their own advice from many, many different accountants. And some accountants feel that if the lease isn't entered into before the contract, then it's not the sale of a going concern, so that the buyer still has to pay the GST. And one of the biggest problems I see when people are negotiating these contracts is they get advice from the buyer's agent, they get advice from us, the lawyer, but they don't actually check with their accountant what the accountant's going to do. And at the end of the day, the accountant, the seller's accountant, is the one that needs to sign off on the BAS and lodge the BAS on behalf of their client. 99 times out of 100, they're going to be doing it for their client. The times that I've seen in the past where it's after settlement, and then the accountant's looking at it 60 days later and they're going, I don't think that this was actually a sale of a going concern. It's scary that it comes up. So I've actually taken to the practice mission where I'm acting for a seller, of actually getting them to talk to their accountant about it beforehand, if there's any question on this, and actually ask their accountant, if they're going to lodge the tax return, their BAS, what are they comfortable with? Are they comfortable with it being signed at unconditional? Are they comfortable with it being signed at settlement? Or are they going to want it before the contract? So I'd involve them at that stage. So that way, in 60 days' time, when they're going to lodge the BAS, they're not coming back knocking on the door asking for money. Whilst I'll get it back, people don't want to have to fund that 10%. 10% of a $4 million property is $400,000. It's a substantial chunk of money to fund waiting for a refund. So Very, very important.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think that's a really important point, and that's why we're asking this question. So it's brought up an interesting point to have that lease. And it's not always with a lease back. It's often with a re-lease. So in other words, signing a fresh new lease. We're looking at one at the moment where the lease effectively expires at the end of November, but the tenant's very happy to sign a new lease. And I'm saying, well, we're only signing that contract subject to the new lease, which makes perfect sense. Mm-hmm. So again, selling agents, a little bit of a pushback. And I'm saying, mate, what have you got to hide? You know, because if you've got an eager tenant that wants to stay on, his lease is coming up. It's just giving him certainty, really.
100%.
So, you know, get on with it. Seriously. Mm-hmm. So yeah, that's a very good point that you've just brought up about the GST. We've run into that a couple of times. It's never been a problem, but it is something to bear in mind.
Yeah, and it's only a problem, and it only comes up as a problem when the accountant goes to lodge the VAS, and then they bring up this as a problem because they all have they don't all have a different opinion. Yeah, there are different schools of thought about which way is going to work. So yeah,
of course. You get accountants and you get accountants.
That's right. Yeah. And you get bookkeepers and yeah. Anyway, it's something important to think about as you're working this whole transaction out.
Yeah. So Jeremy, I think we've covered off on quite a couple of things here. Mm. And I think the crux of the matter is to have a good solicitor looking at your contracts. And with all due respect, buying commercial property is all about contracts. It's looking at leases, which is a contract. It's looking at your legals. It's the actual sale contract. It's all about legal. So you really want to make sure that you have got the right team on your side.
Yeah.
If anybody would like any information, reach out. You know where to get hold of us. And I want to thank you, Jeremy, for making this time. It's been very insightful, and I think we're going to have you back on to have more exciting conversations about resumptions and rules and regulations.
I don't know whether anyone's ever said that talking to a lawyer was exciting, but so thank you, Mish.
I need to retract that one now. That's great. It's been very useful information. I think with the questions that we've had, we've touched on quite a couple of good points. So thank you. Thank you very much for time and joining me today.
Thanks so much for having me, and I look forward to next time. Cheers.
Thanks. Bye now.